Hey, good morning, everybody. I'm meteorologist Alex Alisi. Thanks for joining me here on our first live weather school. Be sure to ask questions there in the chat. I will try to answer them as they pop up. And if we don't get to them today, we will be doing this every week, so we'll be sure to try to write these down and answer them for you later in time. Hopefully everyone is enjoying time at home. This is mostly geared towards kids stuck at home who want to learn a little bit more about weather and science. So again, be sure to keep those questions coming. We got a few of them yesterday as Ashley went live there asking for your questions. So I got one question from Donna talking about sunsets and why are sunsets a little more red at night. Sometimes they're redder than other times of the day. Sometimes with the conditions in the atmosphere, they're really bright and brilliant red. Other times, well, it's not as beautiful. Well, here's why. Let's talk a little bit about the atmosphere first. So why are sunsets reddish? Well, the atmosphere, it's a bunch of particles of air from the surface up to the top of the atmosphere. If you think about it, if you've ever been on a foggy day and you're trying to look down through the fog, you're looking through a large portion of that fog, it's hard to see. There's more of those molecules between what you're trying to look at and something off in the distance. Well, if you're to look straight down through the fog, there's a lot less of that moisture and it's easier to see. You have less to look through. Same kind of thing with sunlight. As sunlight is right above you, all that light is going through a shorter distance through the atmosphere to get to your eye. As it starts to set, we'll go ahead and take a look at these graphics here. The sunlight has a lot further to go through as it's lower on the horizon. It's going through miles and miles of atmosphere on the horizon all the way to your eye instead of just coming straight through. So take a look. Again, sunlight has further to travel to reach your eye as it nears the horizon, and that's why it starts to turn a little bit red. Sunlight, it's white light. It consists of multiple colors from red, orange, green, yellow, indigo, blue, violet. The whole spectrum of colors is all within that white light. Now, the wavelength of that light, I know I'm getting a little technical, so if this is confusing you, please be sure to drop a comment here and we'll try to answer. As the light starts to travel through the atmosphere, the different wavelengths of light, red being the longest wavelength, blue being the shortest wavelength, the atmosphere, the particles in it start to scatter that light away. We start to see less and less of the full color spectrum of the light. We just start to see specific portions of it. Now, dust particles, any smoke, dirt in the atmosphere, that tends to scatter those higher wavelengths, the blues, the greens, those colors. Let me try to put this full screen here. Let's do this one. So it starts to scatter more of those shorter wavelengths, the blues, the greens, and that's why we start to see the blue sky starting to dip away first. The red light with that longer wavelength, that really doesn't scatter easily. So that really reaches us. We start to see those the air and dust particles really scatter that red light not efficiently. So as it gets lower and lower in the atmosphere, as that light has to travel through more and more of the atmosphere and more of those air and dust particles, we start to see the red light as it reaches us. It starts to scatter more of that blue, the green, the oranges there. You can see that. That's showing distance from the sun to you. And you can see again those purples, the blues, and the greens really start to scatter away a little bit faster. So again, as you can see by this graphic here, as the sun gets further and further down to the ground, that's why you see more of just the red. You don't see much more of the blue sky colors. Now, what makes this different from day to day is, well, sometimes we got a little more, we have some more dust in the atmosphere. I don't know if we've seen it too often here, but I know out west when we had those fires, it's throwing a lot more smoke into the atmosphere. That's why that sky looks so red, especially even in the middle of the day. If there's more dust for that sunlight to work through, that has more of a chance for that white light to be scattered, and we see more of the red colors. Especially again at night, we start to see the moon. Have you ever noticed the moon low on the horizon? Why it looks so red and brilliant? That same reason. We see that white light reflecting from the sun off the moon into our eye. And as it's lower in the atmosphere, we see that white light getting scattered through all the dust, all the atmosphere to our eye. And that's why that moon looks so beautiful, really, and large and red on the lower parts of the horizon. But as it rises up through the sky at night, we start to see it more during the white. So, and if you guys would please, I'm trying to explain, I'm not a teacher, so I'm trying to explain as best as I can. So if you don't understand, please be sure to ask a question. We've been getting a few questions yesterday as Ashley asked for these questions for our weather school. Again, we're just trying this out. We got a few experiments. I recorded two of them yesterday. They should be pretty interesting. We're going to be releasing those on Tuesdays and Thursdays as well. Hopefully everyone's enjoying the daylight. Let's ask another question. Why is my temperature different? So a lot of people ask this question. You know, we say the official temperature, we'll go with this example here, it's 89 degrees. But people are saying, well, at my house it's 97. Well, why is there a difference there? Well, most people don't have their thermometers in the official way that the National Weather Service records it. You can see on the official recording, it's about 4 feet up. It's inside of that enclosed container. We're starting to see it's always shaded and it's not right up against the house. I'm not saying you're wrong when you take your temperature, but it's not the official way we take air temperature. So on an average house, most of the time, it's not shaded. You have to be able to read it. So you're not going to put a thermometer inside of an enclosed box and not be able to see it. But that's why if it's in direct sunlight, the sun is baking, that thermometer tends to be a little bit warmer. Also, dark colors absorb more heat and reflect it back onto the thermometer. So again, most houses aren't, well, I guess some are painted white, but a lot are usually use some darker colors so that absorbs more heat and again throws off the official temperature. Now on those official recording boxes, they're all painted white, and white light tends to reflect the heat a little bit better. As we take a look also at also in an average house, it's usually near concrete. That can add some more of that radiant heat. As the surface of that concrete starts to heat up, we start to see more of that heat hitting the thermometer, radiating up to it. And again, it gets a little bit warmer. The Stevenson box is what it's called that they put those thermometers in. It's usually about 4 feet above the ground in an open field to try to limit that artificial warming from the sun heating up the ground. Now, this is usually, also want to say, thermometers for official recordings are usually located on airports. Most of the time, Weather Service is great about placing those thermometer boxes away from the tarmac. Again, the tarmac is black, the runways. Black absorbs heat. If you've ever been outside on a hot summer day, walking around barefoot in the grass, and then you step onto the street, what happens? Your feet start to burn because the sunlight really absorbs all that heat there in the roads, the black road blacktop, and it gets pretty hot. Well, if you have a thermometer right above the blacktop, it tends to warm up quite a bit. So I remember when I was out in Omaha, Nebraska, the Weather Service, or at least the thermometer at the airport, must have been right in the middle of the tarmac, because the thermometer there, we called it the Epley effect, the Omaha Epley Airfield, was always tending to be about 5 degrees or so above what we're actually seeing around other spots. So again, it's really important if you do want to make a weather station at home that you put your thermometer, you put your weather station away from blacktop, away from the driveway. Don't put it on your roof with the asphalt, with the roof, the black shingles. You want to get it away usually in the middle of your backyard, about 2 feet up inside of a shaded box. So again, I hope everyone's having some great questions there. Somebody else asked about wind currents. We'll be answering that one a little bit later. I got to prepare a little bit better for that. There's a lot of information on why winds, at least here in the United States, generally flow from the west to the east. Still has to do with air pressure and different cells of air circulation around the earth. So we're going to be answering that as well. But we got a whole bunch of stuff coming for you guys as we go over the next few weeks as everyone's staying home. Hopefully everyone is staying safe. Again, please feel free to ask your questions as I'm explaining this. Gene said, when you guys talk about time of sunrise, do you use the time it first peaks or when the whole sun rises? That's a great question, Gene. There's actually a few different ways to talk about sunrise and sunset. I'm a pilot. I do aviation a lot. And the way we record our nighttime hours, it's very different as well, because there's something called civil twilight, which is an hour. Now I got to brush up on my piloting stuff. I haven't flown in a month since everything locked down. But I believe it's an hour before and an hour after sunlight. It's called civil twilight. So that's when the sun is below the horizon. But once the sun sets, you know, it's still a little bright outside. So that's that civil twilight. After an hour after, it's dark after sunset. Hour before sunrise, again, you start to see the sky starting to get a little brighter. You see the sky all red because of the sunlight going through most of the atmosphere, getting scattered by those dust particles. That's still twilight as well. So when we talk about sunrise and sunset, We use once that sun rises above the horizon or once it completely sets below the horizon. That's sunrise and sunset. Will there be a session on thunderstorms? Jessica, because you asked, there will be a session on thunderstorms. We'll be sure to talk about thunderstorms quite a bit. Thunderstorms are fascinating. There's a lot of there's different stages of thunderstorms. The cumulus stage of when the thunderstorms start to build. You have the mature stage of when the updrafts equal the downdrafts, and that's when you start getting all the rain, the hail, and then of course the dissipating stage is when again all the rain starts to fall and the updrafts cease and the storm starts to fall apart. So yes, we will talk about thunderstorms. Whole lot to talk about there. I recorded an experiment yesterday talking about lightning and thunder. I'm sure you guys will like that when it comes out. We'll be sure to let you know. I don't know if you ever heard of a Tesla coil, but I have a home-built one that I have inside my apartment that I was using to explain that a little bit better. Nick, I'm hoping you're joking about asking about chemtrails. We do not spray chemicals from airplanes. Those are contrails. Those are the jet engine itself compresses air. That's how a jet engine works. You have the air coming into the front of the engine. It compresses all that air. It squirts it with fuel, ignites that fuel. The air expands, shoots out the back. And as that air expands out the back, it cools rapidly. And if you have water droplets, like you do up high in the atmosphere, or ice crystals, that expanding air and the exhaust acts as condensation nuclei. It acts as a little particle that the condensation could grab onto, and that's why you see it's basically a cloud coming out the back of the airplane. It's not actually spraying chemicals, I promise, Nick. How is lightning created? Well, Guy, again, I wish I had my video just to play, but lightning is created by, let's talk about this for a minute. It's going to be a repeat when we actually show the experiment I did, but so lightning is created by friction. Have you ever on a winter day rubbed your feet on carpet, touch somebody, and you get that little bit of a static spark? Well, lightning is the same thing, only on a much grander scale. Obviously, clouds don't come into your home and rub themselves on carpet, but inside of clouds, you have these ice crystals called grapple, these little tiny ice crystals. And in a thunderstorm, obviously, you see those clouds building rapidly, all the updrafts. Well, as the cloud continues to build upwards, all these ice crystals are bumping into each other, sliding against each other, creating charges, just like you rubbing your feet on your carpet. These ice crystals are rubbing against each other, and it's splitting up these charges. And eventually, when you get a big buildup of negative charges at the bottom of the cloud and a lot of positive charges at the top of the cloud, lightning happens. Lightning is just equalizing that charge between the cloud, and you get that big lightning bolt. Now, if you have cloud-to-ground lightning, same thing. You got those ice crystals bumping around. You get those charges separating. You have a bunch of negative charge on the bottom of the cloud, which wants to be equal. On the ground itself, you have a lot of positive charges that tend to like to come up to the top of treetops or the tallest objects around. And when a lightning strikes, again, that's just the Earth wanting everything to be equal. That's just an exchange of charges between that lightning bolt, and that equals everything out. Tammy, I'm glad you like to learn about weather. So, please ask your questions. We'll continue to answer them as best we can. Again, the lightning question, we're going to have a better video to explain that. I have some poorly drawn examples because I'm not an artist, but you'll see the poorly drawn clouds and charges. And then, of course, the Tesla coil I got going on with some singing lightning. I did another one on air pressure. So we'll talk a little bit about air pressure. I have another experiment in mind to also demonstrate air pressure I haven't gotten a chance to do yet. I know Cam is recording some videos. She's got one on convection. It's going to be great. Another one on clouds and different cloud types, so be sure to tune in for that. Counting seconds between lightning and thunder, is this true per miles from your house? Jennifer, yes. Because of the difference between the speed of light and the speed of sound, obviously the speed of sound is much slower. Knowing that, when you see a lightning bolt, if you count, I forgot what it is. I'm pretty sure it's every 5 seconds is a mile. Don't quote me on that yet because I wasn't prepared for this question, but I'm pretty sure it's every 5 seconds is 1 mile. Because of that difference of speed of light, speed of sound, if you see a lightning bolt and you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then you hear that thunder boom, it's about 1 mile away. Hold on, let me actually search to make sure this is true. Lightning to thunder. Yep, every 5 seconds, 1 mile away. Look at that. I can remember things. So, yes, that is actually true. Now, if you hear thunder at all, if you don't even see the flash, though, but if you hear thunder, it's time to get inside. No matter how far away that thunderstorm actually is from you, if you hear the thunder, it's time to get inside. That's why they say, if thunder roars, head indoors. If lightning can strike up to about 30 miles away from a thunderstorm, so that's what you ever hear the phrase, bolt from the blue. That's what that's from. It doesn't have to be right over you or even right next to you. It could be 30 miles away and a lightning bolt can still strike. So lightning kills. Be sure to get inside if you hear thunder, especially during this time of year now that we're getting closer to summer. Why does humidity affect our muscles? Billy, I'm not sure. I don't know if that's a thing. Let me, I'm going to write that one down, Billy, because that would be the first time I heard about it. I'll look into that. Why does humidity affect our muscles? Interesting. So thanks for the questions. I will be sure to answer them the best I can. Now that it's starting to get a little bit warmer, we're starting to get a little bit more storms coming in. Have you ever heard about, let's talk about this, talking about muscles and weather. Have you ever heard about, you know, especially some older people with arthritis? I have a metal rod in my leg because I broke my leg, so I feel it too. They always say, you know, I can feel a storm coming. That's actually true. I didn't believe it until, again, I broke my leg two, 3 years ago now. But because of an injury, there tends to be little air pockets in there. Now, as the storm gets closer, the pressure tends to drop. And if that pressure drops quickly on the outside of your body, on the inside of your body, that air starts to expand. Have you ever seen a hot air balloon? I'm not sure if you've seen that. As it goes higher in the atmosphere and the air pressure outside gets lower, the balloon tends to expand. Well, same thing. That's happening inside of your body. So those air pockets inside of your knuckles, you can hear them crack. I can't crack my knuckles now. But that air tends to expand as the pressure outside drops, so you start getting achy. So, yeah, that's actually a thing, too. If you have ever heard somebody say, oh, I can feel the storm coming. I can feel the storms coming. It helps me as a meteorologist. It gives me a leg up on the competition, I'll tell you what, with my broken leg. So, again, be sure to – I'm going to cut this off here as I'm rambling on. So be sure to ask your questions. We'd love to answer them. We're going to be doing this every week. Hopefully everyone's enjoying their time at home. Be sure to ask your questions. Again, I'm Pittsburgh's action weather meteorologist, Alex Alesi. Have a great day, everyone.